Human beings use classification to put things into logical groups, and if you think about having 10 million species on the planet, that's a number that's just too big for us to understand. And so we need to somehow put things into logical groups so that they make some sense, and we can make order of all of the diversity around us. So when we classify things, we use some basic characteristics: size, color, and shape. When you do your reading in the text, this would fit with the morphological species concept. You know, does it look like a red-tailed hawk? Does it look like a whale? Does it look like a big brown bat? If it does, then that's what group it should go into. DNA is a more modern technique that is also used for classification, and you can examine parts of the DNA, and more closely related species will have more sections of their DNA in common. And we'll talk more about that technology later this semester. And then we also use behavior and habitat. There's a lot of just determining, you know, this species is living in this particular area, and these group of organisms are acting in the same way, so they must be part of the same species. In reality, biologists use all three of these to classify organisms. Taxonomy is a specific kind of classification that's based on evolutionary relationships. So we're trying to put things in groups not just based on color or size, but to represent evolutionary groups. And just to give you a simple example to illustrate this, let's say you have two families, each with a boy and a girl, and we decide to classify that group of people. We could put all the men in one group and all the women in one group. We could put all the adults in one group and all the kids in one group. And those would be logical classification groups. But what we're probably most interested in is who's related to who. Who's the parent? Who's the offspring? This is a phylogeny. It's a representation of the tree of life as we sort of understand it right now. This is really undergoing a lot of revisions at this time. It's called a tree because we do have this sort of main trunk, with the idea that all these branches going off of it represent the different organisms that are alive today. And at each branch point, you could imagine a ancestral species, something that doesn't exist anymore that maybe gave rise to the different groups. All of life fits into one of three domains. So we have the bacteria, archaea, and eukaryotes. If we look at the tree of life, we're sitting right up here. Fungi and plants are other ones that you might recognize, but there's a lot of stuff on here that you might not. If we look at the three main domains, we have the eubacteria, also sometimes called the bacteria, the archaea, and the domain eukarya. I recommend trying to just say these words out loud so they're not so intimidating. The eubacteria are the regular bacteria. And what we mean by that are the bacteria you find in the soil, on the doorknobs, sitting on your table, on your computer mouse that you're breathing in and out right now. Those are all the regular everyday bacteria. And certainly some of them cause disease, but many of them don't. The archaea are sort of coined the extreme bacteria, and many of them live in environments that 30 years ago we didn't think life could exist at all. And if you look at some of the names of the archaea here, the halophiles — halo means salt and philia means love, so these are salt-loving bacteria. Then we have a couple that like to live in methane. Here we have Thermoproteus, which likes to live in very hot environments. And interestingly, the group that's studying most about the archaea is NASA, because they've got microbiologists studying whether, if organisms could live in extreme environments here, could they also live in extreme environments like the moon, comets, Mars, that kind of thing. Finally, we have the domain eukarya, and eu means true, and karya refers to nucleus. So these are the true nucleus organisms. Technically, these are any living thing made of cells with a nucleus. And everything you think about that's not bacteria, from redwood trees to owls, to grass, all of those things are going to be in the domain Eukarya. So it's a very big group, but what they have in common is the nucleus, and we'll explain more about what that is a little later in the semester. Within the domain Eukarya, we have four kingdoms, and these are the kingdoms that maybe sound more familiar to you. We'll still have this group called the Kingdom Protista, and this is a hodgepodge. It really isn't a true kingdom anymore. It's going through reclassification right now. But right now, it includes all the different single-celled organisms. And we've got plants-like single-celled organisms, animal-like single-celled organisms, and fungi-like single-celled organisms. And this also includes the algae, what you would call seaweed. So being single-celled is the one thing that all of this group has in common. Over the next 10, 20 years, you're going to see this group be completely reclassified. The Animalia, everyone is familiar with the animals. What all of the organisms in this kingdom have in common is that they are multicellular, mobile at some point in their life. They don't have cell walls, and they have to feed on other things to get their energy. The plant kingdom. These guys are also multicellular, non-mobile. They can certainly move to adjust to the sunlight or something like that, but generally they don't move around actively. They have cell walls made of cellulose, and they get their energy from a process called photosynthesis. Fungi. These guys are multicellular, non-mobile, so they're sort of plant-like in that regard. They have cell walls, but their cell walls are made of chitin, and they must feed on other things for energy, so they can't use photosynthesis. So to give you an example of how this classification scheme works, here we've got a human and an ostrich. And obviously, humans and ostriches are quite different. But if you look internally, you actually start to see some characteristics that are in common. And it turns out they have almost all the same bones as we do, they're just in a different configuration. And that's an indicator that maybe there's some common ancestor back there. So, looking at the classification of a human and an ostrich, we start out with this biggest group, which is the domain. Remember, there's three domains. We're in the domain Eukarya because both humans and ostriches are made of cells that contain a nucleus, and neither of us are bacteria. Within Eukarya, there's the four kingdoms, and we both qualify as the animals because we are multicellular, we move around, and we have to feed on other things to get our energy. Phylum is the next group underneath the kingdom, and there's about 39, depends who classifies it, 37 to 39 phylums within the kingdom Animalia, and both of us qualify as chordates, which means we both have backbones. Then within the chordata, there are a number of classes, and this includes the mammals and the birds. And this is where we split up. So we are the chordates that have fur and produce milk. That makes us the class Mammalia. And ostriches lay eggs that can survive on land and have feathers. And that makes them the class Aves. We can then follow the classification down farther for humans. The order that we're in is the primates, and we are actually the brachiating mammals. Brachiating is a fancy word for being able to swing your arm all the way around in a circle. So if you're sitting at your computer, you can stretch and do this right now. And think about your dog and cat and a horse and a zebra and a walrus. None of them can swing their front arms around the way we can. So that's unique to primates. The hominids are the upright walking primates, and this is the point in our classification when we are all alone on the planet. We're the only species in this family. And then Homo sapiens is our genus and species. Homo means one, and sapiens of the earth. A scientific name is actually a representation of the classification of a species. So we said earlier, if a species has been described, it's been given a scientific name, and that means it's been placed in this entire classification scheme. So someone's figured out right where it fits. The scientific name is actually just the genus name and the species name put together. If you have two species that are very closely related, they will have the same genus but a different species name. Scientific names are always in italics if they're typed or underlined if they're handwritten. And so if you were trying to figure out the human scientific name, you could look here and see easily that is Homo sapiens, which most of you have probably heard before.